Blackstone Audio and Skyboat Media present The End of the Sentence by Maria Dahvana Headley and Kat Howard. This book is read by Stefan Rudnicki. For the horned and the hooved, the detailed devils, and the unphotographable, or for the monsters. Chapter 1. There used to be a woman who lived at my house. She's gone now. When I got here, nobody'd lived here in years. They'd given me the key to the padlock, and so I took the Greyhound. There was a little town, but it wasn't much. A mile of paved road in the middle of dirt. A hardware store, a diner, a gas station. I walked 5 miles in the heat because there weren't any taxis, and nobody I wanted to ask to drive me from the drop-off. People were already acting like they were noticing me, and I felt nervous. I could see them in the window of the diner and in the hardware store, looking out. I'd bought the house in an online auction, sight unseen, repossessed due to negligence, city selling it. The house cost $3,000. It came with a bone-silver, paintless Chevy that didn't run. It was what I could afford, almost nothing. But this was the kind of nothing you might do something with. The place, in the picture I saw online, reminded me of my grandparents' house in Louisiana. It had shutters hanging crooked and a little porch. When I saw my house for the first time, it was the beginning of October and still up near 90 degrees. High grass all up around the walkway, and I made a note to cut that down so it wouldn't catch fire. I felt good about that, like I'd learned some things. I pictured a fence, some green grass, some flowers, and then a swing set and a little boy swinging. But I didn't have a little boy. I didn't have much but the backpack I was carrying and the jeans I was wearing. I'd lost some things along the way. I was 38 when I got to that house. I had had a whole life before this one. Wooden, weather-stripped paint and a flap in the front door for the mail. I looked at the house and felt sad for it. It had been yellow. There was a tree stump from a tree that had been big. A bathtub in the front yard. Nothing growing. Too long with nobody watching over it. Somebody next door had had a meth lab which had burned up. It was still a black rectangle. The place looked country, and it was. But it was the kind of country that could kill you. I unlocked the padlock, unfastened the chain, and pushed at the door. It stuck, like something was behind it, pushing back, and I hesitated for a second. What if someone really was in there, living there? A squatter. "Hello," I called out, feeling stupid. I thought I'd know if there was someone there. I shoved one more time hard, and the door sighed and budged. Mail, that was all. A pile of it. All over the rucked-up floorboards, stretching down the entry hall in an overflow. Hundreds of envelopes. Some yellowing, some newer. At first I thought it was going to be collection notices, junk, used cars and cable TV, but they were all the same. Long white envelopes with handwritten addresses in slanted handwriting. They were all addressed to the same person. Olivia Wayland, 57 Snakebite Road, Ione, Oregon, 97843. The return address was for the federal prison 200 miles away in Salem, and the pre-printing on the envelope said, "Correspondence from an inmate." Each letter was red-stamped, "Approved." I held one in my hand for a minute, and then put it down in the same spot I'd picked it up from. None of my business, I thought. I'd heard some people had a fetish for corresponding with prisoners. Maybe that had been Olivia, whoever she was. I had a packet of hot dogs in my backpack. I picked my way over the envelopes, went into the kitchen, turned the knobs, established no electricity. I slung my bag down on the ground, squatted on my heels, took the hot dogs out, and ate one raw. I needed to eat them or cook them, and there was no cooking.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.